Hello, my name is Keshwani.
That's K-E-S-H-W-A-N-I,
Keshwani. We are here because we want to prepare for the GMAT, math portion of the GMAT. Starting from today, you and I are going to work together to get ourselves ready, as I said, for the math portion of the exam of the GMAT. We will use this book, The Official Guide 2021. If you do not own this book already, purchase one immediately. You're going to need it. You must have the book in front of you because I'm not going to write down every single problem on the blackboard. The story begins on page number 62, number 1. Let's get going. If you decide after watching the video that you would like to work with me, that you would like to hire me as your tutor, I provide, as it says here, online math tutoring for all of these exams, and you can reach me at keshwaniprep@icloud.com. Let's get going. So we're given a picture here. It's not drawn very nicely, which is why you have to have a book in front of you. And it says, so if you look at the book, if you look at the book and read it properly, it will tell you that we have six identical squares. And we are told that each with side 1, each of these six squares has side equal to 1. The question simply is, what is the outer perimeter? What we need to understand here is that because we are told that these squares are identical and they all have the side of 1, it doesn't matter how long this side is, where it ends, and how much is this portion. That portion and that portion constitutes one side, because that's the other side here, because this is made up of two sides here, because it's not, I forgot to do that here. It tells you something like this here. This is how it's given to us. So hence the six squares there. So let's just count the sides. 1, 2, 3, and this part will make it 4, 5, 6, and again this part and that part is 7, and then we have 8, 9, 10, and then 11 and 12. As you can see, it's very simple, very straightforward. In the beginning, the problems are going to be very simple, as a matter of fact, almost silly, almost ridiculous. The answer is 12. The perimeter of that picture is 12. Let's look at the second one. In second one, we are told that we have performances R, F, S, and U, and the prices are given here: $40, $50, $40, and $50. There were four musical performances, and the tickets were sold for either $40 or $50. And this is how many tickets were sold. Tickets sold, we are told. For the first performance, we sold 200 tickets, then 240 tickets, then 220 tickets. And the very last performance, we managed to sell 300 tickets. Question simply is, what's the difference between maximum and minimum revenue? The difference is maximum, minimum revenue. Well, that's pretty straightforward. Maximum, you can see clearly here, this is where we charge the highest price for the ticket, and this is where we sold the most tickets. 3 times 5 is 15, and then we have 3 zeros, 1, 2, and 3. $15,000 we got for the last performance, and here the revenue is going to be the lowest one because we only sold 200 tickets for $40 each. This is also 40, but we managed to sell 220 there. So 4 times 2 is 8, so it's 8,000. There we go. The difference is $7,000. The difference between the maximum revenue and minimum revenue is $7,000. Number 3, we are told that we have 4 people, C, J, M, and R. C, we are told, drove 72 miles. This guy drove 78 miles, this guy drove 83 miles, this guy drove some number of miles, and we are also told that they drove an average of 80 miles each. They drove an average of 80 miles each. Question simply is, in order for the average to be 80 miles each, how many miles must R have driven? Well, we can do it in a traditional way, the classical way, the conventional way, or we can do it the quick and dirty way, which is simply, if everybody had driven 80 miles, the average would have been 80. But everybody did not drive 80 miles. This guy drove 72 miles. He's 8 miles short. Had he driven 80 miles and this guy driven 80 miles, this guy's driven 80 miles, then this guy must have driven 80 miles also because the average is 80. This guy drove 8 miles less than that. This guy also drove 2 miles less. So far we have a shortfall of 10 miles, but then this guy drove 3 miles more than what the average is. Which means since we have a shortfall of 10 miles here, these two people must make up a shortfall, this shortfall of 10. This guy already made up 3 miles. So this guy has to drive 7 more miles than the average. And if he drives 7 more miles than the average, then he must have driven 87 miles. He must have driven 87 miles. Number 4. See what that has to say. It says that the person is getting commission . I'm not sure if commission has two S's or one S. If it only has one S, then I'm giving one more S to this guy as an additional commission. And the commission is, he gets 15% of first $500 of sales that he makes, and then he gets 20% of sales above $500. So if he has any sales above 500, anything above 500, he gets 20%. For the first 500, he gets 15%. The question simply is, what is his commission on $1,300? He had a sales of $1,300. Commission on $1,300 sales. Sometimes it takes longer to write the bloody thing than to actually do it. So here we go. Here's the first 500, and then the next. Since he had 1,300 total, first 500, 500 minus 1,300 minus 500, he must have had 1,800 more. For the first 500, he gets 15%. 10% of 500 is 50. If 10% of 500 is 50, 5% of 500 must be 25. So there is your 15%. And for the next amount, he gets 20%. 10% of 800 is 80, so it's 80 times 2, which is 160. 160 plus 75, whatever that happens to be. 160 plus 75, whatever that happens to be, that's your answer. Do you understand? Number 5. In number 5, we are told that we are going to mail some letters. And we're going to mail, we are told, 1040 letters. And in those letters, we're going to put coupons in those letters. And each letter gets 2 coupons. Question is, how many are left over? As you can see, the bloody thing is just too silly. It's very straightforward. If each letter gets 2 coupons, 1040 is what we are selling. 1040 letters is what we are mailing. 2 times 1000, because each one of them gets 2 coupons, 2 times 140 is 2000, 2 times 1040 is 2080. We have 3000 to begin with. 3000 minus 2100 would have been 900, so it's going to be 920. It's a very, very silly thing to ask. But the story, did I muck it up? I believe that is correct. The answer should be 920, number 5. That's right. D. The answer is A. And what I just said is, in case you misheard me, I don't want you to get excited. What I said was, did I muck it up? Mucked with an M, not an F. Did I muck it up? Did I screw it up? Did I make a mess of it? Did I make a big breakfast out of it? The answer was no, no, no. Or to be more precise, the answers were no, no, no. Number six. In number six, we are asked to find the coordinates of point R. Coordinates of point R for a picture that looks something like this. And I will do my best to make a decent picture. So here is point P. Here is point Q. It goes straight down. This, we are told, is 45 degrees. This, we are told, is 90 degrees. All of that is important information, because if that is 90 degrees, and so is this one. And if this is 45, then so is this one, because this is also 90. Because it's a straight line, we are told. This is point R, this is point O. And all of that is stated in the problem. I'm simply not putting it on the blackboard, every nitty-gritty things. Do you understand? All right. So we are told that P has the coordinates of 0, 3. This guy has the coordinates of 5, 3. Question is, what are the coordinates of point R? Let's see what we can do. Well, the x coordinate of point R is very straightforward, because it's a straight line. X coordinate of point R is going to be the same as x coordinate of point Q, so that's 5. And then what we need to understand is that because this is an isosceles triangle, O, what is this point called? Well, they don't have a name for it. Let's give it a name. We have OPQR, let's call it S. This triangle OSR, because this is 45 degree, this is 45 degree, therefore, because that's 90, which means it's an isosceles triangle. It's an isosceles triangle, which means The length of OS
is equal to the length of SR.
And O to S we know is 5, which means S to R must also be 5, except it is going to be negative. The coordinates of points R are 5 and negative 5. Make sure you pay attention to it so that you don't end up picking 5, 5. I'm sure 5, 5 is also one of the answer choices. Has to be. Yes, it is. So the answer is not C, it is E, 5 and negative 5. Let's keep on going. So that was number 6. Number 7.
Number 7, we are told that the regular price is $500. And it is reduced by $150. The question simply is, what is the percentage drop?
What is the percentage drop? Again, very straightforward. It is reduced by 150. We know 10% of 500 is 50. This is just 3 times 50, which means it's simply 3 times 10%. The price is reduced by 30%. Price is reduced by 30%. Number 8. In number 8, we are told, rather, we are being asked. So we are on next page here, page number 63. At the bottom of the page, on the bottom of the first column, rather, we are given these quantities:
half minus one-third plus one-third minus one-quarter plus one-quarter minus one-half plus one-fifth minus one-sixth. And the question simply is, how much is this quantity?
1/2 minus 1/3, 1/3 minus 1/4, 1/4 minus 1/5, 1/5 minus 1/6. Question is, how much is that quantity? Now, what they are hoping, and what some people will end up doing is to calculate each of these separately, because they have parentheses around them. And if you do them separately, it will take a long time. Don't do that. The thing to do here is to remove all of these parentheses. They serve no purposes. Because they have plus sign, when you remove the parentheses, you don't have to worry about changing any sign. Just remove all the parentheses, all of them. Just remove them, just ignore them. In your mind, simply ignore them. And if we do that, we immediately realize that these quantities are given in this manner for a reason. As you can clearly see, we have a negative 1/3 and a positive 1/3. They're going to drop out. We have a negative 1/4 and a positive 1/4. This negative 1/4 and positive 1/4 will take care of each other. We have a negative 1/5 and positive 1/5. They're going to take care of each other. They're going to cancel out each other. So what we are left with is simply 1/2 in the beginning and minus 1/6 at the end. And that's all we have to figure it out. And that's very straightforward. Just make the common denominator of 6, multiply this guy by top and bottom by 3, and you have 3/6 minus 1/6. 3/6 minus 1/6 is simply 2/6, which of course is just 1/3. Let's go to the next one. Number 8. Or rather, number 9. We are told that we get $11 per week to mow the grass. We are told that we get $4 per day to walk the dog. Okay, make sure you pay attention. You don't want to end up mowing the dog and walking the grass. And we are told that the owners are going to be away for 3 weeks. Question simply is, how much amount is paid? If I agreed to do the job for the owners while they are away for 3 weeks, every day I go there and I walk their dog, and every week I go there and cut their grass, how much am I going to make? So let's find out, shall we? So here is the mowing, and here is the walking. How many times am I going to mow the lawn? Well, it's per week. They are away for 3 weeks, so I'm going to mow it 3 times. So this is what we're going to make for mowing the grass. And then we're going to walk the dog every single day. 3 weeks has 21 days. So 21 days I'm going to walk the dog, and each time I'm going to make $4. And that's all there is, nothing to it. So $33 for mowing the grass and $84 for walking the dog, a grand total of $117. Number 10, we are told that we have $48,000 in profit. And we are told that this profit that we have, $48,000 in this business, is to be shared among two owners and 10 employees. How is it shared? We are told that the owners are going to get, owners get 3 times as much. Each employee gets equal share, and each of the two owners are going to get 3 times the share. Question is, how much does each owner get? Very straightforward. So here are the owners, and here are the employees. So let's pretend that each employee gets a grand total of X dollars. That seems like a reasonable amount. That's how much I would expect to get if I were the employee. I'll walk up to them and demand my X dollars.
And since there are 10 of them, altogether they're going to get 10 X dollars. The owners get 3 times the amount that each employee gets. So first owner gets 3 X dollars, and the second owner gets 3 X dollars. So 6x altogether, 10x for them, grand total of 16x, which has to equal $48,000. So 16x equals 48, which means x has to equal 48 divided by 16, and that is going to be 16 times 2 is 32, so it's going to be $3,000.
$3,000, is that the answer? We have to pay attention. What does $3,000 represent? $3,000 represents the x, which is the amount of dollars that each employee got. And the question was, how much does each owner get? The answer is, each owner is going to get 3 times the amount. Not the 3,000, which is what the employees are going to get each. The owners are going to get $9,000 each.
Let's keep on going. I have no idea how much time we have spent so far.
I don't want videos to be too long, but let's see what we have.
Number 11, we have $500 that we're going to exchange for euros at the rate of 80 euros for a dollar.
Not 80 euros, rather 0.8 euros.
And then once we have exchanged our,
once we have converted our dollars into euros at the rate of 0.8 euro per dollar, whatever we get, whatever amount that we're going to get in euros, we are told that we're going to spend 3/4 of that.
And then convert the remaining euros back into dollars.
Question is, how many dollars are we going to get at the end? How many dollars are we going to get at the end? So let's find out, shall we?
So we are told, in the beginning, we are told that each $1 is worth 0.8 euros. Well, we don't have $1, we have $500. So let's multiply both sides by 500.
So that was straightforward.
And let's write our 0.8 as 8 over 10. 8 over 10 euros. This is how many we're going to get. 8 over 10 over 500 makes it easier to calculate. So this 10 is going to go with this thing. It's just 50 times 8, which is 400. 400 euros. We're going to get 400 euros and we're going to spend 3/4 of them. 3/4 of 400, we're going to spend 300 euros. And we are left with 100 euro. We're going to convert that back into dollars. And we are told that again, 1 euro we know is equal to,
oh, I left out part of the story here. We're going to convert the remaining euros back into dollar at
$1.20 per euro.
$1.20 per euro. So 1 euro is worth $1.20. So 1 euro at the end, we are told, is worth $1.20. But we don't have 1 euro, we have 100 euros. So it's very simple. Multiply both sides by 100.
That's all. So we're going to get 1.2 times 100 is $120.
We're going to get $120 back. I think I'm going to stop here. That's the end of the page. Seems like a logical place, because if I were to turn the page and start over there, it'll be silly to stop in the middle of the page. So we did 11 problems, we did 2 pages. Perhaps tomorrow we'll do some data sufficiency problems. We're going to mix them up. We're not going to continue doing just simply multiple choice problem and then do all the data sufficiency problem, because then it'll be too damn boring, too bloody boring, because we'll end up doing multiple choice problem one after the other, and data to do the data sufficiency problems continuously over many, many videos. I don't know about you, but it will certainly bore the pants off me. And I'm not too keen on that idea. You understand? I'll see you tomorrow. Like I said, if you wish to get hold of me, just send me an email, keshwaniprep@icloud.com. I provide online math tutoring for GRE, GMAT, SAT, SAT, as you can see, all of these exams. And also any of the general math subjects like algebra, geometry, statistics, calculus, whatever you like. Right? Bye now.